welcome to Sidekick Podcast. And before we get started, say hi to my producer, Corey Gomez.
Hey, how's it going tonight?
It's going good. And listen, before I bring on my guest, which I'm excited about, I want to tell the audience a little bit about him before I bring him on. He's a very good friend of mine. He's a former martial arts world champion, a 5 times world champion, forms and weapons. He's also an actor, stuntman, and Corey, you can be interested in this. He's also a online trainer and a fitness trainer. So we're going to be talking about that at the end because I'm very interested in that as well. Please, everybody, say hi to Keith Cook. Hi, Keith.
Hey, how you doing?
Good. See, Keith does, he defies time. He looks like he's 35 years old, and he's not 35. I saw him on a little video clip earlier where you're doing the spinning back kick against the bag, and
Yeah.
a jump spinning back kick on the bag. And you said, "Hi, I'm 63 years old," and you did it. And I went, "Damn, that's like impressive. That's pretty cool. I really enjoyed that." And we'll stick that in here as well later because I love that so much. Now, we were just together a few months ago. We were in a film called Black Creek, and which was filmed in Arizona, and I really, really enjoy that. Why don't you tell the audience a little bit about that film and some of the characters, some of the stars, big stars that were in that for martial arts stars?
Yeah, I mean, I was really blown away. I mean, first, it was the most time I ever got to spend with you, actually, which was really an awesome honor. And just, it's so good to get to know you better, you know, and because you were really a hero of mine when I was back, you know, competing, you know, before I ever got out on the national karate circuit or anything. So it was just really, really like a dream come true. And Benny the Jet, of course. I actually filmed you guys in the hotel rehearsing your without permission. I was filming you guys when you were rehearsing your fight scene, and it was so cool. It was just really, you know, I felt like I had popped into another dimension or something. And it was really, really fun. And then of course, Don Wilson, Cynthia Rothrock, Richard Norton, you know, and I got to have a fight scene with, just kind of a small fight scene with Don Wilson. I figured out I couldn't beat him, so I shot him, you know.
Well, so I have to ask you about that. It was a Western film. It was cold as can be in Arizona. So I know, my gosh, I have a small cameo. I'm not one of the main characters. You are. Did you fight any of the other characters? Were you a good guy or a bad guy? I never could figure that out.
Well, the my character starts out as a good guy. You know, supposedly I'm Cynthia's character, Rose. I'm her old boyfriend from before she left town, and I'm kind of hoping that I'm gonna, you know, I don't know how much I'm supposed to reveal. I'm kind of hoping I can get back together with her. But yeah, it starts off I'm a good guy, and then you start to figure out I'm not so great, you know.
Well, what a wonderful experience to have Don Wilson, Benny Akitas, and Marcus Taylor.
Taylor.
Oh my God, Richard Norton. How cool is Richard Norton? Is anybody cooler than Richard Norton on this planet?
Oh,
you know,
my.
When I grew up, I wanted to be Richard Norton.
Yeah. Well, you know, you guys did it. You've done movies together before, right?
Right, right. Yeah, my first fight scene was with Richard Norton in a film called Force 5.
Yeah.
And And back in the days when I used to compete and train, he would come down, he'd fly in. If he was in the country, he's from Australia, of course, so he'd fly in into Atlanta, hang out with me, and work out, and we'd go out together. And he's like my mentor, you know. I just really looked up to him so much. I just remember you had an impact on me as much as he did almost. You're not even aware of this. I was nervous about my first time acting, and he gave me some tips. But it was after I did Wheels on Mills, we were talking, and you gave me a compliment about Wheels on Mills, and nobody had at that time. I don't think anybody had seen it. You had seen it earlier.
Okay.
And I just thought that was the nicest thing in the world because I didn't have much of an ego about acting at all. I just thought it was terrible. For you to come up to me and say that you enjoyed my performance in that film, I just went, you know, you hit a home run with me when you did that, because I didn't think anybody even knew who I was or anything else. So that was kind of cool.
I'm glad I said something, because I really did enjoy that film and your fight scene and also Benny's fight scene. You know, it was really good to see American competitors do well on film and look good on film. You know, it was really awesome.
Well, that's a good point, you know, because we're proud of each other. We're always pulling for each other. And I think, believe it or not, I just had a small cameo role, like I said, in Black Creek. But it was definitely one of the best experiences of my life. I was fortunate to have my wife, Kathy, with me.
Yeah.
That she got the chance to meet. But we got to hang out together. We got to spend time with Richard Norton and Benny Urquidez and Don Wilson. I mean, Cynthia Rothrock, that's like golden, isn't it? It's
yeah.
the small things that make the most, mean the most. It's not big car, big house, yacht. Those little memories are my favorite memories. Those are what you hold on to.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I felt a little beside myself, you know, getting to play a cowboy too, which, you know, who would have thought, you know, that I would get that opportunity, you know, and it was so much fun. I enjoyed it so much, you know, and I had a good amount of dialogue in the movie. So I would go, like a lot of times I wouldn't hang out with everybody. I'd go in my trailer and practice my lines, you know, because I wanted to be so ready, you know, and I really enjoyed it, you know, I got to say, and it was really, it was cool. Meeting Mike Moeller and the whole stunt team too that they put together from Germany, and it was just
how do you enjoy working with him.
Yeah,
how do you enjoy working with Mike? Did you enjoy working with him?
Yes, very much so. Yeah. Yeah,
I did too. I thought he was just the greatest, you know. And it's so wonderful, you know. I have so much. Here's the thing: these guys in Europe, they grew up watching our films.
Yeah.
You know, so he was behind the, you know, the Eastern Curtain. And so as soon as the curtain went down in Germany, he went out and he started buying these videotapes. And the videotapes he would buy would be all our kind of movies, the martial arts movies.
Yeah.
And so here we're working with this guy, and he was beside himself. He was so happy to spend time with you and Benny and half the crew. So it was a delight working with him. I thought the whole production was really nice. I wish Cynthia Rothrock the best. I think it's going to be a hit. It hasn't been released yet. But when he comes out, I think it's going to do well, and I wish him the best.
I hope so, too. I really do. Yeah.
Well, let me ask you this. I'm so fascinated by your training in martial arts and your relationship with the Wushu team in China. How did that come about?
Well, my original martial arts instructor, Roger Tung, I'm from Seattle, and I was a Bruce Lee fanatic, you know. I just thought he was the, you know, the most incredible thing I'd ever seen. And so I wanted to take Kung Fu. You know, I didn't really know if there was a difference or anything, but I knew that that's what Bruce Lee did, you know, or at least I thought that's what he did. And so, you know, I went to the Seattle Kung Fu Club in Chinatown. It was upstairs, kind of secretive place, you know, and you know, my dad took me down there. I was 13 and we knocked on the door and they kind of opened up like this and I could hear people, but they wouldn't let us in to watch a class. And so I was like, okay. And that was the most expensive place because I wanted to go to the most expensive place because I thought, you know, if they could charge that much, they must be good. that was the way I figured out. And we couldn't get in to watch a class. So I just kind of gave up on that place. And then I saw Roger doing a demonstration at a street fair at the University of Washington in Seattle. And I was just blown away. I thought he talks like Bruce Lee. He looks like Bruce Lee. He's fast like Bruce Lee. And I was just blown away. So I became a student of his right away. And I remember it was like $22 a month, the tuition. I don't know why that popped into my head right now, but that's what my dad had. Hey, my mom and dad had to pay $22 a month, you know? And then and for $22 a month, I went every day, you know? So,
well, how do you hook up with the Wushu team of all places to go to China?
Yeah.
You see, most people don't realize watching this, we take martial arts in a martial arts dojo or school or studio, whatever. And that's how we learn. You I mean, you did the extraordinary. You went to China.
Well, Roger always kept a connection with what was going on with wushu in China, even though we weren't quite doing the modern kind of wushu that they do quite yet. The Beijing wushu team, well, actually, it wasn't the Beijing wushu team. It was Jet Li as a young boy, about 10 years old in 1974, came and did demonstrations. And we somehow got a videotape of the demonstrations, and I was blown away. I was like, wow, yeah, how do you do that? You know, and Jet Li, 10 years old, was just sharp, you know, like really, really mature movement and clarity and power and stuff for a 10-year-old, you know. And so I was like, these people must be tremendous fighters, you know. And you know, I didn't know exactly what it was at the time. And then we went and actually saw them in person in about 19, about maybe I can't remember what year it was. It might have been about 1979 or something. The Beijing Wushu team toured the US, and I went down and saw them live in San Francisco, and Jet Li was a part of that team too. So I saw him in person too. And
Hey, let me ask you, Keith, was he at the, in 1980, the Wushu team came down to the Oakland, in San Francisco, Oakland, and they did a demonstration at the Oakland Coliseum, and it was the World Expo. Were you there?
that's what it was. Yeah. That's what it was. I came down for that. Yeah.
Get this, I fought that night for the World Championship, and then first time I had any exposure
I
with
was
the
there.
Wushu
I
team.
saw that. I saw that because I can remember all the places that I've seen you, but
Oh my gosh.
man, I always just enjoyed your just the creativity in your fighting and your slipperiness and your athletic, you know, smoothness and speed. You know, it was just
Well,
fantastic.
thank you for that, but I felt like after watching the Wushu perform,
Yeah.
and I just said there's a different level. You know, I was working real hard to get to my level. Then I went, oh my gosh, there's a whole nother level of martial arts I wasn't aware of. And when I saw it, I was just blown away. I just couldn't believe what they were doing on stage.
Well, they were probably blown away by you too, by the way.
Oh,
But
shoot.
no, the
I
thing is, they didn't fight. You know, they did forms, and they did a very, you know, it's kind of like, you know how that whole thing started with the tricking? They call it, they sort of call it tricking
Right,
you
right, right.
know, the 540s and stuff. I
Yeah, they're
think,
doing it in 720s. They're doing it now, yeah.
yeah. And I'm pretty sure that a lot of that was inspired by wushu, you know. And it was amazing the things that they would do. And I finally did, you know. He took a tour to China, and I went actually at the same time as Donnie Yen. We went to the national champion wushu championships in Fuzhou, China, in
Wow.
1980. And Donnie Yen was on the same trip with his mom, who was a Tai Chi master from Boston. They had lived in Boston at the time, and he demonstrated. I demonstrated sparring with Roger at the national championships in China, and Donnie demonstrated mantis, you know. And then after the tournament was over, he went to Beijing to train, and I went to Nanjing to train. And I spent over 3 months there training, like 6 hours a day, 6 days a week, and learned a lot. And my body got pretty beat up. But the thing is about the way they jump and stuff, it's really good to work out with them because it's a rhythm thing, you know, like when they take off and when they kick and stuff in the air. And I just learned a lot about doing jump kicks, you know, from being around them. It kind of gets contagious on you, you know, luckily.
Get this, you threw out 6 hours of training like it was like an afterthought. Do you know we don't train 6 hours? What was that like?
Yeah, I mean, I got shin splints, you know. I just it was a grind. It was grueling, you know? And for me, I had never trained like that, but that was a good wake up call for me, you know, that these, they would train, you know, 3 hours in the morning, they would have a little bit of schoolwork and, you know, academic stuff. And then they would eat lunch and take a nap, and then they would go back and train again. And, I got in that routine with them, and, you know, I guess it, the effect it had on me was like, kind of like, oh, this is what it takes, you know, to be a professional athlete, you know, because, you know, being a communist country, they were in the dormitories with all the other athletes, the divers, the gymnasts, the, you know, track and field, you know, you name it, you know. And it's an official sport there, just like those other sports are, you know. And I got really into it. And when we came back, Roger had moved to LA, and he said, why don't you come down here? I know you want to get into movies. You can come work for me down here. And I moved down here in 1985 and started teaching at Roger's school. Really, I ran the thing because he traveled so much. I was just there running the school, you know, and he brought the Beijing team in for demonstrations. By this time, Jet Li was making movies because this was 1985, I think. And so I got to train with the Beijing Wushu team again. And it was just really, really great experience. And I ended up winning the all around national Wushu championships for the US twice. I think it was 85 and 86 or 84 and 85. So
you were doing weapons and forms too, weren't you?
Yeah. And I fought, I mean, not in the Wushu tournaments, but I fought
right
on the circuit.
I've seen you. You don't realize how we've seen you compete before. This is probably something you don't know. Maybe you do, because you worked with Keith Strandberg before.
Yeah.
I met Keith Strandberg back then in the early 80s when we worked for a company called Impact. It was the kick and shields that this company created or produced.
Oh.
And they had an LCD readout. You would hit the target. It would read out how much, you know, power that you were hitting the targets.
Yeah.
So they hired me as the person who would demonstrate it. We set up booths. We go to all the national tournaments or tournaments around the country. Keith was hired as the writer. So Keith and I would go together, just us two. We'd play basketball at night, do other sports at night, but we'd go to the tournaments, and that's where we would see you compete.
What year was this?
You compete.
Oh.
It was from 81, 85.
Okay.
You know,
okay.
Back in the early 80s.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
We were watching you compete.
Okay.
And we saw you compete. And you remember, we had – people don't realize the talent back there in competition, because a lot of you guys and girls went on to make films. Like, let's figure out some of the names. Billy Blanks, Cynthia yeah. Rothrock, George Chung. Mm-hmm. Who else? There was the Ree brothers, Philip
yeah.
Ree.
Yeah.
Jeff Amata. I mean, think of all the people you were training and working out with and competing against. You guys all made it in the films.
Yeah, yeah. It's sort of, yeah, I don't think about that often, but, you know, when you bring it up, it's actually kind of astounding, right?
Yeah. And, you know, I'm a history major, you know, USC. And mm-hmm. so I analyzed everything. I wasn't faster, bigger, stronger than anybody, but two things. I wanted to be like Chuck Norris, who was really analytical. Chuck was the smartest fighter I ever saw fight, but I wanted to be in better shape. And that reminded me of your training with Wushu. I was a distance runner in college, and so I ran distance. I had a scholarship, and so I went straight from running track and distance cross country right into competition. And I'm telling you, I had an edge over my competitors usually, because I don't have to be better. I just have to be better in shape. And when they're tired at the end of the fight, you know,
yeah.
I was just in better shape. And that's basically how you were. You were just at a different level. And I always thought, like, there was the George Chung's. George Chung reminded me so much of Bruce Lee. You know, they're wild and they can do anything, but they're not technical in anything. You know, mm-hmm. John Chung, remember him doing forms?
Yeah.
He was technical. I have you categorized as a technical person. You are mm-hmm. very technical, powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Bruce Lee is technical. He's not wild and crazy like Jackie Chan. Working with Jackie Chan, I was just amazed at all of his gyrations. There's no form on anything. There's just wildness. And George Chung was that way, but you were the opposite. You were just like, you were Bruce Lee. There's a couple fight scenes that you had in films that I had, I was startled. I thought you were Bruce Lee. Your techniques were so fast and exact. You reminded me of Bruce Lee when I saw you.
Oh, wow. That's a huge compliment. Thank you.
Oh, my.